have a problem with the chairs. Yeah. I think we did one more chairs. Thank you so much, Thomas. I really appreciate it. Good evening. I'm Roxana Markoch, Senior Curator of Photography. Welcome to this forum, which is organized in conjunction with the new photography series and its current edition, Ocean of Images, which I co-curated together with my colleagues, Quentin Bajac and Lucy Gallen. I'm not sure where Lucy is, but yes, both of them are there with the assistance of Kristen Gaylord. I'm extremely pleased to have an outstanding group of featured speakers this evening, artists and scholars, who have joined us actually to discuss, to reflect, to examine some of the major changes in image culture of the past 30 years. And I will start with maybe the artist, Thomas Demant, whose work I'm sure you know, you've seen internationally. Thomas is also a curator, an artist curator. Thomas' work was presented in New Photography exactly 20 years ago in 1996. And also I had the great pleasure of collaborating with him on his retrospective exhibition at MoMA in 2005. David Hartt, his work is currently on view, the Belvedere Photographic Series in Ocean of Images. And I encourage you all to see it in case you haven't yet. The show is running through March 20th. Erin Shirreff, her work is also on view here in New York. So I would go to see it in an exceptional exhibition, which is called Photopoetics, an Anthology at the Guggenheim Museum. And then Darsie Alexander, who is the executive director of the Katonah Museum of Art. She's also a curator, and she's a former MoMA colleague. And Darsie organized the new photography in 1998. Then Charlotte Cotton, who is a curator in residence right now at the International Center of Photography, author of numerous books, most recently, Photography is Magic. And our colleague, Thomas Lax, associate curator in media and performance art, who is also co-curator of the Greater New York exhibition currently on view at MoMA PS1. Also, I encourage you to see that one. So before I give the platform to our speakers, I would like to introduce, in fact, the new photography series by saying that it was inaugurated in 1985, and since then it has introduced the work of 100 artists very early in their careers. And when it was launched in 85, it was sort of spearheaded by John Tcharkovsky, chief curator at the time of the photography department here, with a clear intention of placing contemporary photography at the crux of the museum's curatorial initiatives. And I would love to show you a few slides. I'm not sure where. Yeah. Okay, great, thank you. So a few slides, just very quickly, some of the highlights of this series. So this is the very first edition that was curated by John, and it presented the work of four, in fact, unrelated photographers, all American. They were all working with black and white photography. And the works, as you can see, they were, the installation was rather classic. Works were matted, they were framed, presented one after another. Yet the methodologies of these artists were very diverse, and there were documentary, stage, experimental, and also photojournalistic strategies at work. New Photography 2, which was also organized by John, sort of departed from this idea of unrelated photographer. It had a thematic, And in John's own words, it was photography's kind of difficult relationship to the issue of narration. And that was in the work of Philip Lorca di Corsia, Mary Frey, and David Hansen. Now we are kind of fast-forwarding 10 years ahead with New Photography 12, which was organized by Tom Collins. And this was the very first edition, which was comprised entirely of works made by artists from outside the United States, and also which sort of veered away from a medium specificity. And this was the exhibition in which Thomas de Man's work, as you can see, was included. Then New Photography 14, which was organized by Darsie Alexander, presented the work of four artists whose ideas were, in fact, informed by other mediums. These were altogether artists working with other mediums, primarily with video, but also sculpture and light installations. John Dunning, Olafur Eliasson, Rachel Harrison, and Sam Taylor Wood. Now, fast forwarding another 10 years ahead, New Photography 2009, which was organized by Eva Respini, she looked at the East and West Coast of the United States, specifically works by artists working in the studio, not the outside world, in the studio with a dark room and very much involved with post-production processes. And New Photography 2013, which I organized and which included the work of eight international artists who have expanded the field of photography as a medium of experimentation and intellectual inquiry by specifically sort of looking at the histories of photo books, photo montage, science, and also performance. And so now here we are. New Photography 2015. I should also mention that this series happened on an annual basis. It's in fact the only series of contemporary art, with the exception of the project series, which was happening with such a fast beat every year, sort of responding to what was happening in the field. And when Quentin Bajac, our chief curator, arrived at the museum and that we were just sort of brainstorming about new photography and how it should evolve. He thought that on the 30th anniversary, it was time to present it biannually on a biannual format, that it had graduated from what it had been as a more showcase series featuring just artists' work, and to actually expand both its physical and conceptual premises. So New Photography 2015 includes work by 19 artists and artists collectives from 14 different countries. And it has a thesis. It's a thesis exhibition. The thesis is a post-internet generation, meaning artists who are making pictures with a consciousness of the network or the system within which images exist and they circulate. And the installation was rather demanding for a photographic exhibition. It included works by both new bodies of works, but also new commissions specially made for this exhibition. And primarily by artists who were probing the way that we are experiencing the world today, meaning through pictures that were born digitally, that were made with scanners or lenses, that were displayed as still or moving pictures, that were distributed as zines, that were morphed into three-dimensional objects, or that they were remixed online. And there is, for an exhibition that deals with a post-internet generation, a great sense of materiality. As you can see, curators were taking things in their own hands, installing. And that's an interesting paradox of it, that we are not talking about just virtual images here. Now, the exhibition has a title, which is also something new, Ocean of Images, which makes reference to the internet as a vortex of images, as a site of piracy, as a system of networks, but also to what Jeff Wall has referred as the kind of liquid intelligence of photography, meaning the photography is not necessarily, as we may think, just fixed. It is not even about just a decisive moment, but rather it is fluid, that is continuously developmental, temporally morphing. To show you one example, for instance, Katja Noviskova, Estonian artist who is working in Berlin. Katja's work, as you can see here, well, I should say just a couple of words. She's very much interested in evolutionary processes, in human expansion. And what you see here is an installation in the Agnes Gant sculpture garden, where she has these photo cutouts of termites and a peacock spider, which she took from an image sharing website where a scientist from Australia who discovered this new species of the spider placed it on. So I would say that Katja's work is not so much a representation of the natural world as it is a representation of information systems, since it deals with image sharing sites. The DIS Collective, who was formed in 2010 and as a sort of post-internet image-based magazine style collective, and has since branched out into other image-based activities, including the fact that they are a curatorial team organizing the Berlin Biennial this year. We collaborated with them. In fact, they collaborated with us, both curatorial and marketing teams here at MoMA, to develop an image that became the signature image for the exhibition that was spread throughout town, that was in the galleries, online. And that is a portrait of Conchita Wurst, who was a 2014 Eurovision winner, song winner, and became also a symbol of virality. So, you know, there is a certain affirmation about sort of the power or the impact that a single image can have through global communication systems. Now, the real question that that Ocean of Images ask is not what is this picture of or what does it represent, but rather what are the decisions that constitute that image. And it's very much involved with issues of communication, networking, circulation of images. And this kind of 24/7 aspect of images that we constantly experience every day is not necessarily sui generis, but rather it has a history. It can be traced back to the beginning of the 20th century with a media explosion of pictures after 1924, after the advent of the handheld 35 millimeter camera with perforated film with a wide aperture lens. Artists began working at higher speeds, but also experimenting with montage and more dynamic modes of media production, to the point where the Weimar sociologist Siegfried Krakauer spoke about this phenomenon as a blizzard of images. And here you are looking at Katharina Gansler, whose photo mural is in the Bauhaus staircase at MoMA, and it comprises thousands of pictures that deconstruct and reconstruct the Bauhaus stairway that she combined by taking pictures of the Bauhaus stairway in Dessau that Walter Gropius designed, but also pictures of the Bauhaus staircase here at MoMA, as well as pictures of this architectural motif in two paintings within MoMA's collection, the 1932 Oskar Schlemmer work and the 1988 Roy Lichtenstein painting. So I would say that throughout its 30th course, New Photography has not only investigated various artistic practices, presented new work by artists, but also the sort of evolution of the photographic medium, its character, sort of like its social and cultural properties. And these were some of the discussions that we had with the artists, some of the artists in New Photography a couple of months ago when we had a panel discussion. And today I would like, with this forum, to kind of address more broadly what, in your view, are some of the main changes that have occurred in the last 30 years. And I'd like to start with Darsie.
Okay, can everyone hear me? Okay. Thanks, Roxana. It's great to be back at MoMA. As you mentioned, I was a curator for very early part of my career, and I must admit that this was a bit of a journey back in time. I was recently talking to a colleague, and she said, well, ultimately, isn't our work as curators ultimately somewhat autobiographical? And it is, in a way. I think we have certain epics that we strongly identify with. And as an introduction, I would say that I was trained and came of age during the 80s and early 90s. So a lot of my take on photography was informed by the culture wars, by appropriation, by Reaganomics. All those things that I grew up with as a kid really shaped a kind of critical approach to images that I've tried to hold on to as my career has evolved. So I wanted to just, since part of the task was to think about what's happened since the 80s, I kind of wanted to start in the 80s. And this is, I'm sure all of you know, it's Nan Goldin's Ballad of Sexual Dependency, and I was floored when I first saw this piece, which was probably at the Whitney in the late 1980s, way before I got involved in the art world. And it grabbed me for a lot of reasons, not just the images themselves, which were so amazingly poignant and seemed to represent that period so forcefully, but the way the whole thing was constructed, the clicking sound of the projectors, the way that the soundtrack came in and out of the slides, these sort of abridged narratives that the ballad put together, while also feeling very, very deeply personal. And I think that this genre of work with photography, where it is leaking out into these other art forms and permeating its formats in a variety of different ways, was something that really started with the discovery of this piece, but that I later carried over into other aspects of my curatorial practice, so that I was paying attention to the manifestations of imagery, not just what pictures look like, but how they were deployed. And that really became a theme that I continue to think about. When I was asked to do a new photo, it was a really big deal. I was, you know, a young curator. It was my first show. And I was really super excited about it. I thought it was like the coolest thing happening in New York in November of 1997, which is when I did this show. And in some ways, it was kind of a great exhibition. It was the first museum presentation of Rachel Harrison's work as well as Olafur's, and it was, you know, it was a show that in hindsight for me was really an effort to connect what was happening within photography to other art forms, particularly sculpture. And I believe it was one of the first shows where we actually started to see sculpture in the photo galleries, which at the time felt incredibly radical, although it's rather quaint now. It felt like a very, very bold move. I did not get approval from anyone in the painting and sculpture department to do this. And, you know, in hindsight, I think it was a really, really good show. I'm very proud of it. It also, to me, it looks so 90s when I look back at this work, because when I think about the 90s, I think of an era of really highly constructed images, a really self-conscious deployment of pictures within aesthetic contexts. And in particular with someone like Rachel Harrison and Olafur, they were looking at how photography interacted. Like, and for Rachel, the pictures themselves were like not very grabby. They could be actually kind of deliberately flat and banal. But she always put them in these situations where something really weird and evocative happened just by dint of their presentation. Again, this going back to like the situational context for photography was dictating the interpretive context. Like there was a deliberate correlation, in my view, between what you saw as an image and what you saw as an interpretation, as that image related to other things, whether or not it was books or texts or even going through the solander boxes in the photography storage was really cool because you know, in order to find a photograph by Ache, you had to go through Alpert and all of these other weird people. So there was always this clash of images, and it's so much a process of accrual and connectivity that somehow I wanted to call that out in this exhibition. So if photo at that time for me, and I think for a lot of people, was about this contingent relationship that it had to other art forms and to other formats in which it was being deployed, certainly this was preempted by the work of the pop artist. So as I've become older, I've gone further back in time, art historically, and have a show that's opening at the Philadelphia Museum on Saturday night called International Pop. And it's not a photo show at all, but it does look at how the pop artists, you know, they were very, very interested in photographic imagery, and that's been written about extensively. But the part that interested me in relationship to how how pop artists considered photography was that they weren't, again, it wasn't just about an interest in the pictures themselves and what they showed. These artists really understood dissemination. They understood that it wasn't just about a single image, it was about the context of that image, where it appeared, and most importantly, how often it appeared. So a really intensive awareness about the power of mass media and information technologies was developing in a really, really sophisticated way in the early 1960s, and that became a very important crux and thesis for this exhibition. So to keep to my 3 minutes, and I think I'm doing pretty well so far, you know, that then begs the question of kind of where we are now vis-a-vis this distribution technology. And as I was reflecting back on Nan Goldin and the kind of intimacy of her world that she pictured through slide film, which you can no longer get, and it's, you know, the ectographic projector is like a relic, you can't find it anywhere, that now we live in this moment where I don't even know if there is such a thing as a private image anymore. You know, that the distribution technology has become so excessive, so powerful that, you know, we're not relating to our intimate circle, but whatever we do within our private worlds and document is instantly sort of shot out into this ether and becomes very, very public. So I think for me now, and I guess one of the questions that I would be interested in hearing my colleagues talk about is, what is the publicness of photography and where does it exist as a private medium?
Thank you, Darsie. Thomas.
Well, I need your little box. Thank you. So I'm not a curator. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm not a curator, I'm an artist. And every now and then when I have a window of opportunity, I start thinking about probably orchestrating ideas which I get exposed to by other colleagues together into a very crude and not linear argument about how we all kind of work from the same, you know, ideas, basically. And so I did a show, which was, you know, four and a half years ago in New York. You could see it at Matthew Marks. I curated it for a new museum in Monaco. It was about nature and the renderings of nature. That was basically the whole theme. It was more like, of course, it's always a mirror of my own, you know. It's basically a mirror of the idea, like you say, like, oh, I wish I would have done that. And so I mainly showed things like that. I started with Luigi Ghiri because they had two Luigi Ghiris in the collection, and then I thought, like, okay, it's me and him. I never met him. He was dead at the time. I knew his widow. I just didn't know much about, like, how he would think and how he would tick. And I thought that, okay, we could always talk about one other artist, maybe, which would be René Magritte, a subtle way of surrealism in both works, I guess, and then, or I would at least, you know, claim. But with me, it would be, you watch yourself watching. With him, it would be obviously you know, more like more metaphysical sense of surrealism. And then I thought, like, okay, if then we have three men in one room, two of them dead. That's not good. So, and then I expanded the whole field and it became a whole monster of a show, which I enjoyed very much doing, but then I was so exhausted and I realized that curator is actually a real job. And, and people, I don't want to do another one ever because, like, it's, you know, I'm not envying you guys, really. however, then I had this idea of, like, you know, like, of you just the idea that you have some seen something else somewhere else and you just want to kind of reuse it somehow. And then an art historian told me in totally different context, he said, everybody stands on someone else's shoulders, which apparently is a common saying, which I never heard before. And I thought that would be a very good way of doing another show. So I'm doing a show now. I'm curating a show at the Fondazione Prada in Milano. These are John Baldessari made me the public appearance of the show is by him. He made me these two pictures, which we use for posters and the book and all kinds of, you know, ventilation of the idea. It's about stealing images, basically. The show, I like French titles, they kind of elegant. So the first one was called La Carte d'après nature, and the second one is called L'image volée, which means just nicking an image, just like, you know, like a pickpocket. And it started with the idea, and most of the artists, one of them is actually here, sitting opposite of me, Erin. I started with the idea telling them how if you would find a wallet on the street, would you actually look inside? And, you know, and an artist's interest in looking inside a wallet wouldn't be just curiosity, it would be also, can I do something with it? You know, and in that idea, that was basically the pitching point where I kind of collected stuff over like the last 4 years now, which will be all in the show. We're starting with people like John. We have Maurizio Cattelan. We have like a very good old Menzel painting. Remember the photograph? The photograph geeks know the photograph. Lee Miller having a bath in Hitler's bathtub. Mm-hmm. So if you turn the camera around, there's a painting by Adolf Menzel in the living room. And the rest of the people, you know, GIs, waiting until she's done with her bath, like they're actually starting to cut out parts of the painting, all the heads, which probably are now in a garage in Iowa or something. Mm-hmm. And they left the painting without the people on them, but it was a history painting of the time. They, Adolf Hitler's kind of stuff all went to the German state, and they have it in a storage in the National Gallery, and some restorer in 1949 glued the remaining rest on a piece of wood, and it hasn't been seen since then. And we got that one, which is fantastic because you have a painting basically, which you know it's a master painting, you know it's a historical painting, extremely well painted. It had a history, but nothing is on it anymore. So, you know, that kind of aspect. It's basically three aspects in the show. One is you steal things, literally you take something, you run away with it. There's an Andres Slominski, Ulay, of course, you cannot kind of leave out the big, you know, the one of the best things, Sophie Kall. Then, you know, or Archwager, we found the carpet, which is quite amazing. He did a art by telephone in Chicago, and he commissioned a rug to be stolen, and, you know, the carpet reappeared. Since then, nobody has seen the carpet. So that is kind of nice and stuff like that. And then it goes on to the second chapter, which is you steal what's on the picture, not the picture itself as an object. You steal what's on the picture, and that of course it goes to appropriation, it goes to collage, it goes to reusing of images which you find somewhere, which is probably the closest point to your show. There we go, very contemporary. We have commissioned a couple of works. Thankfully, like people wanted to kind of join in. It goes until, you know, Oliver Larich, who just doesn't respect copyright and gets in a lot of trouble all the time. And he's going to be in there. Erin is in that part. Sarah Swiner is in that part. We have, like, Matthew Hale is in there. Pierre Bismuth is making us a couple of works. Rudi Stingel would be in there and stuff like that. And then we have the third one, which is, of course, again, you can see it's not a very linearly, you know, it's not a theory illustrated, but the third one is, what if you make a picture and you steal something by making a picture? And that gets you to private things first, like Sophie Kall famously, you know, looking through this stuff as a hotel maid and then photographing that, to more like making yourself a paparazzi. You just go out and you film George W. Bush landing in Tegel Airport and making a film of that. reusing, you know, photographs which are not, that don't belong to you, like Christopher Williams, and then it goes up to goes up to Trevor Paglen is giving us, you know, a couple of new works, and then it goes up to like a show in a show, which is surveillance machines from the Soviet Union, which I found in a museum in Los Angeles of all places, and that's curated by the probably most famous industrial designer of our day, which I cannot say the name because by contract he's not allowed to say that, and they really quite wonderful objects because they you look at them in terms of like a hi-fi or like in terms of wonderful design, like a smartphone or whatever, and you realize that they're actually not what they are. You know, like the real spy things have like they have a visual appearance and like probably even a very practical and wonderful and patina and everything, but they're actually something else. And that's the end of the show I'm speaking about. And I think that's also the end of my 3 minutes, no?
When is the show opening?
17th of March, it's in 3 weeks. And it's big chaos at the moment, so.
And until?
28th of August, so it's all the way through summer. And it's, you know, you see a lot of things you will never see again or like you haven't seen before, I can promise that much, but it's also, it's a very eccentric argument. It's not, you know, it's not a historical show. It's not an encyclopedic show. It's like, it's really, we have like, you know, faked banknotes in there. There's this fantastic guy, Rembrandt from, I wanted to kind of show all these things basically, which I saw over the year. There's this guy who made these banknotes by hand, and he would work for 2 weeks for like a 500 German marks thing, which is actually a good salary, but it's still a salary for, and when you see them, you knee down because you think like, these are so amazing. And like at the time, they were really beautiful. So he made all of them by hand. He lived from that for 18 months until he got caught and kind of ended up in prison. But, you know, stuff like that from a police museum in a provincial small town in Bavaria and stuff like, you know, things which are not necessarily all, I can go on and on, and I won't, so thank you.
Thank you, Thomas. Yeah, Charlotte.
No, I haven't got any images. In fact, you know that nightmare where you're sitting in the middle of a crowded room and you realize you prepared the wrong thing? I've kind of got that feeling. I haven't got any slides, but it's quick. And to be honest, I couldn't quite get over the container for this discussion to sort of declare my relationship with this amazing field that you're representing in Ocean of Images. And by that, I mean, obviously, the container of MoMA and the story of modern and contemporary art, and also the container of the new photography shows. And it's not, as you know, I really support you for having done Ocean of Images and for changing up the format of this. New photography, and I really support that. For curators, I think the format of new photography from an outsider's perspective has offered the chance to go off message, off kind of core message, which is a terribly liberating thing. And also, I mean, as Darsie was saying about there being an autobiographical reading of the exhibitions, I think from an outsider's position, there's also the beginnings of a subjective reading, which is unusual within the context of MoMA. To have that. And for artists, there are lots of pleasures of being in new photography. I guess there's the validation that your parents in particular feel when they have their child represented at MoMA. And then just the run-of-the-mill stuff of actually getting a mirror onto your practice when you're asked to view it in such a kind of strident sort of container. But there seems to be some terrors with the format. And the difficulties, I think, for MoMA to represent this moment where one could say that the strongest militating factors in the idea of our image culture do not come from the story of modern and contemporary art. And I think that is also compounded by, although I don't see this personally in the photography department, and obviously if I was a youngster I'd be looking to Thomas's department as the place where exciting experimentation in media and performance could happen. So I'm not saying MoMA is void of a kind of context to really engage with contemporary artistic practice in its own terms. But it's hard, you know, because it creates a sort of vacuum, and none of us can get over the sort of pop idol element of waiting to hear what the new photography list is. Like, we never quite get over the list of names and into the conversation that the exhibition purportedly is striking. So there's an element of it which I think is a bit like the king is dead, long live the king, in the idea of new photography at MoMA and us coming together to talk about image culture. Like, I felt it was too much of a stretch in my 3 minutes to to do that.
Well, perhaps we'll have more time afterwards, you know, to discuss about your views of what generally, and it truly, MoMA is a forum. It's a forum for us to gather. It does not, the discussion does not need by any means to be restricted to this exhibition. In fact, it's not as interesting to any of us to just hear about this show, but rather more to hear about your what you are engaged with and how you see that generally things have changed in the past 30 years. This is more of a pretext, the exhibition, for us. We already had this discussion, as I showed it in a panel that dealt precisely with the exhibition. And I think that it's of more interest to us to hear more broadly and more conceptually about what has happened since.
I'll buck up my ideas from now on in, I promise.
Thank you. Thank you, Charlotte. David.
Great, thank you. Thank you for inviting me to participate. This is a wonderful honor. I'm going to talk maybe a little bit about my own practice as a way of trying to relate to the broader concept. Perhaps to begin with, I find that my work within the context of the exhibition is perhaps a little anachronistic in terms of the way that it sits in relationship to the other photographers. And it made me think a little bit about perhaps the axes that my work kind of functions in. I like to think of my practice as a way to dimensionalize my experience of the world and my place in it. So if we think of this kind of anachronistic element, the ability to kind of move productively along a timeline of approaches, I think that's something that perhaps more consciously, as a result of seeing the work in this context where it is in such kind of high relief, I feel as though I'm beginning to understand how it operates a little bit more. So my practice is interdisciplinary. I make films, photography, installations, and perhaps, you know, that media is another dimension that the work begins to operate in. Primarily, my subjects are what I like to call singularities. They're very concentrated representations of an ideological position. And I think the broad scope of my practice is really to try and accommodate a variety, a full spectrum of ideological potentials. That ultimately is what interests me and provides the coordinates that I can begin to kind of locate my own kind of way of operating in the world. You know, one of the other things that's deeply important to me is when I do choose to make photographs or films is perhaps the idea that through that act, I can bear witness to a kind of idea forming, and through that heuristic experience, begin to kind of understand how it functions in my relationship to it. I think another thing, too, is that I've been frustrated with perhaps the indexicality of photography and film, and the work is taking a much more kind of speculative angle recently, and one of the ways that I've been able to accommodate that is to create a gradient, if you will, between, you know, pure spectacle on one side and something, a completely banal act on the other, and then when presenting it to the audience to render that indistinguishable. I think that's it. I like to stop mid-sentence.
Great. Thank you, David. Maybe Erin?
Yeah.
Would you like to? It's working.
Is it working? Okay. I would say, I mean, my practice is very much related to images, although I make sculpture and video and photographs of sculpture. I use images as material in the work itself, also as source material. But I would also say that my work is unified by an interest I have in the condition of being imaged. Something that I've been thinking a lot about my studio for the past few years is, in a very, very basic way, basic sense, thinking about the space that always exists between you, the viewer, and the thing that you're looking at, and all of the ways that we go about sort of imaginatively filling up that gap. So that's sort of a very sort of basic general characteristic of my work, I would say. But something, you know, when I was thinking about Roxana's prompts for today's tonight's conversation and thinking about specifically circulation and authorship and reception, I was sort of reflecting on how comfortable I've always been in showing in very conventional exhibition contexts and sort of the spaces that are the, you know, that have the carry the illusion of neutrality, the sort of the white cube vacuums. My work has always, I felt very comfortable in those places because they are the spaces that encourage contemplation, encourage a sort of analytical engagement with what you're looking at, an analytical engagement with your experience of what you're looking at. All of this, to me, dovetails very well with my own interest in the studio. You know, and then when you sort of think now, if we're agreeing that we're in this sort of a different moment of image culture, this blizzard or this ocean, you think about the metaphor of this show's title and this idea of being submerged and permeated and sort of surrounded by, it suggests a very different condition of viewership and making. And something that I am sort of curious about as an artist, thinking about, you know, museums like MoMA or other institutions like this, is how they're going to think through, how you guys are going to think through and sort of accommodate and make relevant exhibition models that will sort of allow for this other kind of making. There's certainly many examples in the show that's up right now. You know, there's work that you could sort of, I think, fairly say have been authored by the internet as much as they've been offered by the artist. And I'm just sort of, you know, I feel I'd be very happy myself if the internet didn't exist, but I know that that's not going to happen. It's here to stay. So I feel that I just feel like we're in a different sort of train. I have no idea what it looks like. I feel like museums are stretching and flexing to accommodate different ways that viewers come to the museums. And I'm just wondering what it'll look like to accommodate, you know, artists and how they make and the different ways that they make. And I don't quite know what I'm describing, but it seems like this very sort of fundamental thing that is at the root of all the work that we're looking at on the screens is this notion of being in a space with this other thing. And it feels like we're gonna be, it feels like what's being suggested is a different manner of being confronted with an experience that's more enfolded and of, and if that's maybe too vague, but that's sort of what I was thinking about in terms of tonight's discussion.
Lovely. Yes, Thomas.
Thanks, Roxana. So as Roxana mentioned, I'm the newest, I guess, addition to the newest department, curatorial department here at MoMA, Media and Performance Art. And despite Charlotte's prod to ask me to kind of play certain roles in terms of that novelty in new photography, I'm gonna talk about old things and old people, some of whom you see on the screen. So this is an image by Dina Lawson, a photographer who was in New Photo in 2011. And it's an image she made last year, and it's part of a portfolio she did for Time magazine, in which she traveled to Charleston, South Carolina, in the wake of the massacre of the 9 individuals who were murdered at the Church Emmanuel there. And in the series of images that she makes, as you see here, she decides, instead of picturing an image of massacre to actually picture an image of witness and the kind of everydayness or banality of those who continue to bear witness to those who passed away. The image in the center of the composition is of Pinckney, who is a state senator, and the reverend who was murdered. And so in this image, you kind of see him directly looking back at you in almost a way that kind of evokes or echoes the way that at his ceremony at the funeral that took place at the State House, as you guys will remember, the State House when he was buried continued to have the Confederate flag flying over it, and it was just in the kind of immediate aftermath that there was the kind of protests, widespread protests to bring it down. But in that image, he, in the images that you see of that day, you see both the Confederate flag and the kind of open casket. And in many ways, this is an image that's haunted by other images. And I think that that kind of idea of the shadow archive or the shadow images is something that I think we've all been talking about. I'm curious to continue to talk about. And in that idea of kind of the things that through visuality remain unseen, in many ways is one that comes out of the Black church, in the space that they were murdered in. And we all remember President Obama in his in his remarks singing Amazing Grace and speaking directly to that line of kind of the fact of things unseen. And so there is this kind of relationship to what remains outside of the capacity to be imaged and the ways that images can allude to those experiences felt and otherwise through photography in particular. So one particular shadow image for me of this work is the previous work I was showing you by Gordon Parks from 1956. And similarly, this is an image that kind of straddles between a kind of photojournalistic sensibility. It was made also kind of on assignment for Life magazine, but kind of also functions well beyond the kind of prompt or task that he was asked to perform. And what you see here is an image of a couple from Mobile, Alabama, Mr. and Mrs. Thornton. And interestingly, the image that appeared in the magazine was cropped. And so you didn't get this sense of all of the images that lie before them, which to me, in many ways, is the kind of repository that animates the image, because it reflects the way in which they are already image makers and kind of take a history and an archive of available images and use that to represent themselves. Of course, there's the image of them that appears above them as well. And interestingly, this is an image that actually is a composite, a photo montage, effectively, of two images of them that captures them earlier in their life and by suturing them together effectively performs a wedding photo. But the story that would run eventually became a kind of emblem for the fact of segregation in the United States in the 1950s. And I find it interesting that you have this kind of performance of unity that is itself a kind of farce or a fabrication, both through the original image and the re-photograph of the image, but that then is meant to stand in for a kind of possibility for national unification as well, but are also its its difficulties or its trials. So, in these two images, I guess obviously there's a kind of formal analogy between the kind of frontal viewer looking out. There's also, of course, the fact that these are images that first appeared in magazines. And so in thinking about a kind of print culture that enabled not only the dispersion of multiple images, but the dispersion of images into people's homes, which you then see here, there's a way in which the kind of logic of photography is already made by the people who are sitting here, not only because they sit and form the composition, but actually are making their own compositions in their home. And so as we kind of have been talking about these ideas of circulation, reenactment, authorship, one can see already, a much earlier version of the kind of fluidity of these positions moving back and forth. And if we, just think of two pathways in which the post-internet age might be described, the kind of dispersion of images off of one support to be able to exist in many supports at the same time, a kind of inherently, antagonistic idea to medium specificity, or the kind of idea of coincidence and of production and consumption, the kind of prosumer that the post-internet age has posited, that you know we can at once produce and consume, and as a result democratize the way in which we live in an image culture one can also see in this earlier image. And I think it's interesting that it all kind of comes out of this repository of a kind of vernacular image-making tradition that you see here. And so I guess I'll leave with a kind of another metaphor for ocean, and kind of thinking about Paul Gilroy's idea of the Black Atlantic, this kind of other idea of an ocean that is at once a kind of space of a divide between one point and another, but also a kind of suture, something that brings two things together, very much like this image above these figures, or the kind of suture between images as they exist and live on multiple platforms at the same time, so that they can at once be these kind of emblems of belonging, but also the kind of, you know, deviations from belonging to an idea of national identity.
Great, thank you, Thomas. And now I'd like to open the discussion with the room. I'm sure there are questions. I know Svetlana has one, and there are comments, and I encourage you all to participate. Svetlana.
Well, that was, thank you for that, because I was going to say something sort of off the wall, but after you spoke, it feels like, it's funny that somebody from media would be the person who would show us something looking at the world. I mean, it seems to me kind of contradictory that we have not seen something like that from all the photograph people, and what I really, or at least I didn't feel we did. And you gave me a kind of opening to say something I sort of thought I would say, but wouldn't have said if you hadn't spoken. Because one of the things, looking back at MoMA, and when I'm here, I was living in Berkeley and not here in the previous decades, but my sense of MoMA, which comes from publications and shows, was really Sarkowski and his opponents. And in the old days, they were the vernacular people, people who felt that Sarkowski was for art and the world, but he didn't let in all kinds of makers. There was a real antagonism, be it Chris Phillips, be it Dwayne Michaels. A lot of people were angry, and there were articles written about this, right? Now, what's curious now is that photography has become very various. We're past Sarkowski. Art has won. I mean, there's no question now that photography is art. We don't have to worry about that. But one of the things that worries me is what's happened to the world. It seems to me that what photographs can do, unlike any other medium, is look at the world. Painting doesn't do it the same way. No other medium does it. And until we saw these images here this evening, I'm puzzled by what's happened to the world. Why is photograph somehow not absolutely concerning itself with looking at the world, which only it can do? And sort of your bringing these images in made me feel, okay, even though it's wacky to say it in the face of oceans of images, it seems to me an essential thing that gives me pleasure and will always give me pleasure in photographs.
David, I'm sure you can handle this. Because you are looking at the world, and your work is included in Ocean of Images, just as a number of other artists who are looking at the world. It's true that not everyone is looking at the world in the same way. And I think that part of what of this generation that we call post-internet is that it deals very much with what the word is, and the word can be also an image, and an image can also construct a word. So it's not exactly that they are not looking at the word, it's just that they are not looking in the same way that gives you pleasure, Svetlana. I think David could answer a little bit, since your work is so, in fact, engaged with the world.
Yeah, I'm happy to address it. I mean, I think that was part of what I was addressing with the idea of the work being anachronistic, is that it very much is in conversation with the world and trying to address broader issues and trying to use photography as a tool to begin to understand them. I mean, last year alone, I traveled to the island of Sakhalin in Russia, to White Horse in the Yukon, to Argentina, Chile, Brazil, all over the United States, to the island of Tuvalu in the South Pacific, all to really very much engage with, you know, the idea of globalization and how it's addressed both in the center and the periphery, and to try and understand, you know, a set of possibilities as an artist in relationship to it.
I'm gonna try to bridge it for Svetlana. So, for the question that you brought up, Svetlana, in terms of the responsibility of the photographer, or not the responsibility, but to question why the photographer is not looking at the world and in the show, I think that it's been I don't want to say traumatic, but I think for the history of photography. To suddenly be in a position where the images that you once made and had control over, you no longer had control over. I know Andrea Geyer is here, and I remember reading something of hers, a quote of hers that she said, you know, a past in photojournalism that she leaves because, am I true in reading this? She leaves because of the control that she had over the images was, you know, diminishing, and so she moves into a fine art effort where in theory you have more control, and now, departing from what Andrea did in her own work, there's even the issue of fine art photography of like the late 90s and the early 2000s that was representational, that then goes onto the web, and you no longer have control of the way that it's being seen anymore. It's being usually shown in the weekend pictures type of cycles, like usually 12. I used to get a lot of those emails asking me for exactly 12 images. I've done that too, and I can tell you that what I mean. Thank God for the grants I've gotten, because the work that I do is all over the web, and I don't get paid for it. So thank you, Guggenheim. But it is important, I think, for where we are as photographers, and to talk about how our work is being seen. And I think that's why the show, well, some of the pieces in the show here are more introspective about the medium itself, because we are going through that, I think, as a field of, you know, there was that piece on mood disorders, which is kind of, it's a joke, it's a very elaborate joke, but that the web tells to the photographer. It's not the photographer telling the joke. It's like the computer talking back to the artist, and this is what it did to the artist's photo. So I think it's evolving how the many things that we're looking at, but we can't just say that the world is one thing. We also have to think about our world, I think, as using that medium.
Well, I would like to add, I mean, it might be a complete commonplace, but photography got much more subjective than before in the last 10 years because it got so proliferated everywhere. So everybody is making his own photographs. The selfie is not, for no reason, such a popular image. And you came from a very strong and broad history of like photojournalism, where the photojournalism would be basically saying, okay, this is the North Pole and this is the South Pole, and we show you how the world looks like, and you would know where to find that. And now, if you talk about authenticity of a photographer today or photographs today, you look at photographs since 9/11. In fact, you look at photographs of people which are involved in the making of that news or the picture which comes to you, and that's the authentic photograph. You know, I don't have to bring up all the Abu Ghraib and all these kind of things, but they're all made by people which actually made the news, and that is. At the same time, you probably still see the news, but you see them through the angle of like a single individual and how he or she has experienced the world. And photography is obviously a big mirror of how people think all over the world, and I'm not sure it can give you the key to how to understand the world, but it's just the screens got literally much, much smaller, simply. All they can show you now is yourself with not a lot of context, and that is what we look at photography today. That's what you can see in the nearly solipsistic quality of a lot of photographs which are changed in post-production. Simply, you can do anything. So what do you do? You just don't let the world in there, because the world might be too shocking, or it might be too complex or something. And that happens, you know, and we know, we learn to understand it, we learn to read this, we learn to kind of get a certain pleasure out of it and don't not find it artificial anymore. But it got, you know, the lens, the focus got much narrower in a sense. That's why you probably don't see photography as you used to see it, which tells you something about the world from somewhere else. I'm pretty sure. I mean, even like the thing in Tehran, the short video of the girl dying on the street, it's done by somebody, by a passerby, by somebody who's standing next to it.
There's
when we walk down the street, most people don't look, right? Most people walking down the street are looking at a screen. I sometimes say, stop, I get so annoyed at it, because it's damn annoying. But I don't have screens. I don't have an iPhone, and I look. We still look with our eyes. And one of the curious things about eyes is the world is separate from us. And even though the camera isn't an eye, it can extend the eye. And that is a condition of looking. We still have eyes, Thomas. So to say, oh, it's all self now, still the human animal is still constructed the same way.
I'm not saying it's all self. I'm just you complaining about a certain development of the media. And I'm telling you where it's coming from. It's very simple. It's the machine. And the machine kind of records something else than it used to be. And everybody has a machine. And they talk much more about themselves because they may have much more platforms to talk about themselves than they had before. And the communication photography is standing for is much more one-to-one than it ever used to be.
And you don't think that can be bucked?
No, I think it's a pendulum which swings. Remember the photography where you came from, you know, then you have grand pictures of like Andreas Gursky explaining the world like in a godlike perspective, which are fantastic. I adore him. It's his fantastic work. But that was basically that his outer work, according to Andreas Gursky. That's the world like where we thought that's how it looks like or something. And that explains us globalism, and that explains us. And now it's swung completely into the other direction. Of course, it will swing back in some sort, but it's not going to go back where it was, you know?
There's an interesting article, I think it's by Hedo Stirel, on exactly this phenomenon, which is that at one juncture, photographic veracity, the sense that a photograph was actually delivering something about our real world, came with the sharpness that you described. Now, the kinds of images that we trust as being truthful, as in having taken place at the time of the scene, are a lot blurrier, are a lot more amateurish, and she actually sort of defends this idea of the shift from sharpness to blurriness as being indicative of a different way in which we're reading, quote, authenticity or photographic veracity. So it kind of speaks to what you're saying, that the subjectiveness of the photograph is also carrying forward in just the types of images that we're receiving on the end of, as viewers.
And again, the idea of the poor image, which Hito refers to, it is linked to the apparatus. And so I would just following up on Thomas' mention is that in 1983, meaning, in fact, since we are talking about internet, a few years before the launching of the World Wide Web, the Czech media theorist Wilhelm Flusser, actually in his introduction to a philosophy of photography, he was precisely talking about the two paradigmatic shifts that have taken place throughout human history. And that was the first one occurring in the second half of the second millennium before Common Era, which had to do with the invention of linear writing, and the second one being one that we are witnessing right now, and that has to do with the invention of technical images. And this change, basically, from the linearity of writing to the photographic dimensionality of magic had very much to do with the way that we experienced the world through changes in the formats of the apparatus through which pictures are taken.
I wanted to add, I think, perhaps a complementary point. If we think about photography as a form of time travel, right, William Gibson talks about the future being here, it's just unevenly distributed. and perhaps, you know, the proliferation of images and points of access allows for us to participate in a continuous present that is a representation in many ways of the future.
Makes an interesting relation to the issue of anachronism. Other questions? Yeah.
I was going to go back for a minute to the Garden Parks photograph. And I think we need to be a little careful that we assume this is the world that he's referencing or relating to or whatever. There's a very similar image to this one that appeared in 12 Million Black Voices, a book that Richard Wright and Edwin Roskam edited, and which Parks said he regarded as his Bible in the years before he joined Life. I think it was by Arthur Rothstein. I can't remember. So it could have been another photograph that Parks was thinking about when he composed this. And also, I think somewhat relevant is the fact that on this trip he made, he was constrained in many ways as a black man from the scope of coverage he could actually make in Alabama. He couldn't photograph publicly on the street. So again, this sort of interior photograph of a black family would be a natural subject. And I guess I don't know what he thought exactly he was doing, but I mean, maybe there was an element of bringing what could only be seen in a book written by a black man and very much aimed, not entirely, but to a large extent aimed at black readers, bringing that, the kind of vision he'd encountered there, not to mention the kind of subject matter, to Life magazine, was a sort of photographic step with an impact on the world that he saw himself as making. I mean, it's hard to reconstruct all this context now. I just happen to know a little bit about it. So, thanks.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think what you're describing also reminds me of something that you were saying earlier, Darsie, about the kind of way in which, like, where is the kind of space of the private today? And I think in looking at this image, you very much see the way in which that kind of private domestic sphere was cultivated, but also violated in a certain kind of a way. As much as it kind of becomes a cover for Parks to construct his own kind of artistic vision, it's also in some ways kind of, you know, intervention into, or, you know, a prying eye into this kind of, you know, this space that in many ways you could be argued mirrors the kind of constant way that the space of the black home has kind of been the object of a certain kind of surveillance by the state in terms of, you know, the history of policing. And so I think that there is that kind of liberatory capacity to the image, but also one that, you know, continues another kind of more pernicious logic of the kind of assumptions of the private sphere being wildly available to certain public eyes. And I think in many ways, you know, the question that I have to us is about the kind of space, you know, of the public sphere, the ways in which, you know, the kind of motions to subjectivity or kind of narcissism are also enabled by a kind of participatory logic, and even if it's not necessarily always, you know, towards the kind of idealistic or utopian ends that David was asking us to, that there is, you know, part of the way in which the circulation of images functions, it does avail itself to completely new kinds of public spheres and spaces, not only for discourse, but actually mass mobilization. And so I feel like, yeah, the kind of tension that we're looking for, or distinguishing between the private and the public, I think, you know, is informed by the way in which the individual subject has been further cohered as a kind of political, you know, protagonist that we might want to get behind as a way of, you know, mobilizing a certain kind of change, and that looking at other ways in which the mass or, you know, the social articulates itself in images, in photography, or, you know, in other kinds of imaginations is something that I'm curious, as, you know, we're standing in the center of the eye, for all of us to kind of articulate or evoke.
And I would just add to that photography has now become a point of alignment. So literally on Facebook, we align with images or we don't, either by liking or not liking. So to your point about like the capacity of these new media technologies and the internet in particular to corral forces of people together that are distanced from one another geographically is very, very powerful. And I think something that you really wisely address by bringing up these issues about particularly Black representation, which is, have been very much on the forefront of my mind, certainly as an observer of images over this past year.
I've been thinking a lot about, to sort of generalize for an exhibition that I'm working on for ICP, the difference between maybe a 19th and 20th century photographic motivation, which is voyeuristic in intent. And, you know, it has the wonder of the camera as a passport to deeply forced intimacy. It's like the access point. But then the downside of it is it's perennially defining your other. And then the 21st century, in light of social media, being an exhibitionistic point. And again, the downside of that is this sense of kind of just like cultural narcissism. But then the plus side is both the immense wealth of subjective storytelling and also the idea of self-representation or representation of people like yourself and the connecting with people like yourself as one of real agency, real social agency.
Questions? I mean, I think that there are mixed feelings about the fact whether there is real social agency or whether, because it all depends on how do you understand this level of communication or of being part of a commune of sorts.
Well, I think it does depend on who you
because
are.
Because on the other hand, you know, we are all, I mean, to Svetlana's point, you know, interacting in some form of a telematic milieu constantly. The only time when we don't is when we sleep, basically. That's the only time when that is a private time, you know. But I think there are other ethical dimensions to the issue of communication, basically, through social media.
I think the point as raised is very interesting, though, in terms of perhaps, you know, the lack of resistance in terms of trying to refute it. I'm thinking about ideas of hybridity and porosity. You know, the images circulate across a variety of, you know, different nodes, and there's no fixed idea of what it means. It can be accommodated within a variety of points of view. And I think that that's an important thing to address, mm-hmm. right? In order for Svetlana's position to have a kind of substance, there needs to be a resistance. And if that resistance is diminished, right, and instead is met with something more porous that accommodates it, what happens?
Well, this is part of the premise of this exhibition, of the post-internet generation, is really that the internet exists offline, right? It's not that people are necessarily circulating their images just through the internet. It's certainly the many lives that Thomas was talking about in his show, the many lives of pictures. It's part of this story. But the fact that the internet also persists, you know, offline is another one. The artists that, as you very well know, David, that are presented in this show really work both analog and digital. They work online and offline, virtual and real. Yeah, there is a sense of porosity which this allows for all these aspects of the photographic medium to actually coexist right now. I think that Svetlana's point was that what happens with people taking pictures of the outside reality, you know, being in the world, being on the street. And I think that Thomas answered that.
And I think, but additionally, it's, you know, not being able to muster defense, right? And that's something that I readily admit to. Mm-hmm. I'm very much tired of the binaries. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just entirely unproductive. You know, I see a more productive conversation happening around the porousness and trying to understand what the responsibilities are in terms of understanding that. Like, how do we move forward within that space? without the kind of fixed points, without the oppositional forces.
Any other questions? Yes.
I don't have a question so much as a response to Svetlana, which is that there's no market for those images. What technology has done is destroyed the market that used to support the making of images of the world. And those photographers who used to do that activity are all scrambling to try to figure out some way, some other way to support themselves. So. I'm not sure what to say to that.
I don't think that's an explanation. That is part of the situation, but I don't think that's
an explanation. I really don't.
It's actually even less than an explanation. It's simply a condition.
It's a condition. No, I accept that. I accept that. Yeah, I understand that. I mean, but I would say again, to push this, you know, what Evan said is the difference between me and other photographers is I have an eye. And he said that again and again and again. And are we really saying that nobody has an eye anymore?
But
see, that's what puzzles me. And what Thomas says doesn't really answer that. You're saying, well, it's all subjective. The eye is a distant situation. It's not embracing. And we all have eyes.
But
you're...
I just want to bring attention to the fact that Walker Evans and Walker Evans's eye was also for, you know, a period of time was a tool working in the use of the American government as part of the RAFSA archive. So I think that maybe a way out of that complexity, bringing in another array of tensions into this conversation, might be to talk about the systems that produce these images, the systems that try to take hold of those images and then distribute them as part of their own mechanisms. Life magazine being one example, social media being a whole different example that also involves very particular photographic practices and needs from us as viewers and producers. I'm not sure if this was helpful at all, but I felt like it needed to be said.
Yeah, and it does seem like there's part of, just to put it in certain kinds of formal terms, like a kind of hybridity or a way in which like figure and ground become indistinguishable, a kind of blur that is occurring, which has to do with the way in which, you know, the market, there is a market, but the market is one that we're ambivalently related to in the sense that we're actually generating value by participating, but also that value is for the corporation, whether, you know, it's Facebook, but it's also for oneself. So there's a kind of double-endedness that implicates oneself as at once like kind of adhering to or aligning with the state or with a corporation in a way that is everybody can avail themselves to, but also distancing. And I think that kind of ambivalence or the kind of contradiction or paradox is particularly heightened and hard to parse out in a way that makes one's own ability to distinguish oneself from the world increasingly harder. There's a kind of the kind of flattening is something that implicates oneself as much as one can kind of feel desire at a newfound distance that differently existed. There's a kind of collapse of temporalities that enables a kind of ahistoricity or the kind of anachronistic sensibility that you're talking about. It's enabled by that kind of collapse of self and social that we rally against by kind of proclaiming our a kind of unified sense of subjecthood.
I think that Andrea Geyer has raised her hand.
Sitting behind you. Thank you. I was just trying to formulate, and I'm nearly there, but Thomas, what helped me, like the pictures you brought, I think what they made me think about in this discussion of like the digital and the internet and the photographic print and print in journalism, in print media journalism, I should say, is that the role photography plays as an object in somebody's life, maybe less from the place of making, but from the place of living. And I think the two pictures that you bring in very much show how photography as an object in this way helps to orient ourselves in this world as individuals. So maybe I'm trying to introduce another way of thinking about this relationship of self and photography. through a different mode, right? And then it made me think of Yvonne Reiner's film, Christina Talking Pictures, right, where the wall of photographs, of journalistic images, right, that reoccurs, that becomes this kind of score for us to think through a set of ideas that she's proposing very abstractly. And then it makes me think about, you know, the way in which a lot of images exist for us today, which is in this non-object way, you know, because even though we hold an object, they're not an object. The images itself are very fleeting, and the kind of non-presence of them as things in our lives. I'm wondering, you know, what happens in the shift of how photography and images who exist as photographs have helped us to make sense of our world around us historically and, you know, in our generation still, and how that will change or is changing through the way in which the mass of images we have around us are fleeting. They're not this kind of thing we can take to orient ourselves towards and around. And, you know, it's just an observation that what you brought in and what people are talking about makes me think of. Thank you.
Other comments? Yes?
I just wanted to say, back to Svetlana's point, if this helps. If you concede that we are existing right now in a very image-heavy world, or that there is also a world of images that we are existing in addition to the, if you want to call it, I mean, if you accept the opposition, like a real world that we're existing in, that world of images needs documenting as much as the real world needs documenting. So, you know, Dis and Katya, they have an eye, like Walker Evans does, but they have an eye for the world of images, and what's actually being frozen or documented there is another world that you may not get distracted by because you don't have that phone, but certainly you kind of need a Life magazine for that world as well. So that might be another way of looking at, you know, these actually are looking at the world, just not that world.
That's great.
Well, it seems to me that the show kind of proposes a real distinction from classic photography, where we have a camera here, and what is the camera doing? It's pointing, and where it's pointing is to a type of exteriority, and that's where the value is. But it seems with a lot of new photography, following up on this comment, the where photography points is not necessarily where the camera points. It is less about the imagery outside of itself, but trying to look at the structures that is involved with its making and its dissemination. And whether that ends up being a type of philosophy about photography, I mean, I think the question Svetlana brings up is, does that leave the world too far behind? Does it become a type of meta-looking or navel-gazing?
I just don't think so, because one of the things I find really interesting about the show are the spatial and physical propositions by some of the projects that are on view, and how strange they are. The piece that you pictured here by the artist, I'm forgetting her name. It's a very strange, if it's proposing itself as a sculpture, it's a very strange sculpture. It's a very strange hybrid thing that, as a viewer, as you walk around it, how you feel it, the sort of imagined sort of touch of that, its presence, the sense of scale, enlargement, all of those things are very curious physical sensations that you can have as a viewer if you stay with that work. And a lot of this work, a lot of the images, they flash by, you know, there's this sort of like this, you know, again, this metaphor of the stream or whatever. But if you're really to stay with that thing, I think that proposition of physical being that work inhabits, and some other pieces in the show, I find to be quite startling and very telling and really about our relationship to our bodies and the different ways that we take in information and know things in our world these days. So I know it's not a picture, it's not street photography, of course, but I feel like it's a very telling, they're very telling touchstones about our relationships to ourselves and how we understand things. I think that in Lucas's work, you feel that within the frame, you can feel the touch within the, and I'm not talking about a clone stamp in a field of Photoshop, I'm talking about feeling the dab of the image on the other dab and feeling the crinkle of the strawberry and imagining and thinking about the taste and the all of that stuff, that sort of very strange thin physicality that exists in some of the work in the show, I find to be very contemporary and very telling.
I want to, I think, add to this as well. If we think of the burden of photography is to form a kind of historic record, can a photographer be interested in history without addressing that point? And I think that in many ways, I think that the body of work that I have on display up there tries to address the current moment from an ideological position, looking outward and kind of trying to understand that as a worldview. And in many ways, I think, Thomas, you address the idea of history painting or the burden of photography to record a kind of historical moment through a kind of abstraction and reenactment. I think that you can talk about the issues of photography without enacting them.
Well, I don't have anything to follow on that. I'm sorry.
can I add on to what Erin was saying? I wanted to go back to something. It seemed to relate to something you said in your introduction as well, which was about the relationship between the artist's work and the viewer. And I, you know, when you said it in the introduction and as you were speaking then, it really resonated with me. And in my book, Photography is Magic, the sort of divining rod for who was included in the book was actually about my anticipation of their relationship or the relationship they were constructing with the viewer, and one that is incredibly generous rather than the kind of sort of more sort of the negative argument that it's solipsistic or it's kind of, you know, it's navel gazing, when actually it's a real entreaty to the viewer on the viewer's own terms in relation to the image culture in which we all live. I see that in your work too, profoundly. Like, it seems like that's a major concern of how you, what you decide to render essentially into an object.
For sure.
Yeah.
But are there things that pictured or depicted can have a kind of force upon you without you as the maker intending them to? Like, I'm just thinking, like, these flowers, like, have a kind of, you know, as we're thinking, you know, as Andrea was talking about the kind of life of things, of the, like, the life of things of the images themselves, there's also a way in which, you know, outside of a logic of authorship or agency, you know, images can, like, wreak a certain kind of...
Well, that's part of the view, point of view of viewership, is the behavior of images regardless of authorship, right? Like, I think that's built into the viewing experience.
First one question, and then we'll go there.
Here's one question.
Okay.
It's more of a comment than a question, but something I was just thinking about is how the status of the camera has changed so much that the camera is and the platforms in which one views images are not neutral. You know, like, Facebook is not a neutral platform, Instagram isn't a neutral platform, and I was thinking about just hearing on the news this morning that now, like, the FBI wants to, like, break into someone's iPhone. I mean, the San Bernardino attackers, they want to look into their iPhone to see who they've been communicating with, to look at their pictures, to read their texts. And so even the device in which people take pictures, like, camera, is no longer just an object. It's a repository of all this other kinds of information, which I think changes the sort of the photography that was maybe practiced in the 20th century with the kind of, you know, vernacular photography that's practiced now. And I'm just wondering, as an artist and as, like, a room full of practitioners, like, how that how that change, how this sort of, how the platform and then the camera itself has a different kind of function and a different and registers information in a very different kind of a way.
Can you pass the
One of the things I was thinking about during the conversation and also having seen the show was this idea of time. I don't know if time is the right word, but the way images are engaged with largely today on the phone and, you know, and on the web or this or that, and just so quickly. And one of the show actually has a lot of work that is really boldly sculptural and, you know, has real physical presence and this kind of thing, which I love, because I love this kind of combination of photography with sculpture, and like it's almost like painting is on the wall, hanging in, you know, whatever way. But I think about that, you know, and that's our job as artists, to present that kind of, you know, to present environments or presentations or installations of, you know, that are arresting. And also, the images have to be also arresting. But I'm thinking about the younger, talking about the change over 30 years. Like, when I think about people who are under 10 years old and, you know, consuming images, it's like really quickly. And what is going to stick? This is the kind of, what kinds of images stick with that very young generation, for example? And that's something, this idea of time, because there's so much, we consume so much and see so much and absorb so much, I don't know. You know, and so that's something I was thinking about, what's changed, what's changing, certainly for, I would say, probably myself, and we're all probably of a certain generation that I think has changed, is this idea of like this quickness and this element of time, and the photograph being this static piece, always has been a static piece, we can sequence them, blah, 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 but how much of that, like what is the, I don't know how to put this, but what is going to be so, what is going to be arresting, you know, and that's something, this idea of time, like how much we're going to absorb it is problematic for me, a huge thing to think about.
I have a...
Well, I was just going to very briefly respond to that, which I think that it's not so much about the stickiness of images anymore, because I think we can all agree that we're moving through them really quickly. I think the stickiness and the duration element has been replaced by this notion of navigating portals. So if you're on the internet or you're looking at an image, one image will lead to another door, and you'll go through that door, and that'll lead to more images, and that'll take you on a path. And I think that path is a path that you can navigate at your own rate, but... you know, one of the things that I was contending with when I was writing this is, or thinking about this talk, is just the, like, has the internet in a way created a kind of emptying out of the kind of the deep content that I love, you know? And I mean, I think that, like, underneath this conversation, and that kind of goes back to what you were saying, Thomas, just you're getting into the content of this image and what it represents and the story that it tells. And I think we're, you know, the conversation that we're having tonight is sort of toggled between like the platform, outlet, network side of things, and then like the pictures themselves and what they deliver, and whether or not the two are, how the two interact with one another, how the what's contained within the image and what is produced by way of the network work together or not to create a pleasurable or a an emptying out kind of position.
I think I have an 8-year-old and an 11-year-old, and recently they got my wife and I into Seinfeld. I never watched Seinfeld when I was growing up, and somehow they came upon it, and they've become obsessed with it. Now, before bedtime, we'll usually watch an episode. And, you know, I really love this idea, but I think it also begins to kind of represent, you know, when we think of the ocean of images, it's not just about image production today. It's also about what I like to think of as the great sorting, which is looking back at, you know, the last 150 years of image production and bringing it online and having to deal with that tidal wave as well. Mm-hmm. So it's almost as though we're being, you know, crushed from both ends. And you know, that goes back to this kind of sense of trying to navigate, you know, a new sense of responsibility. And the porosity is one that's also temporal.
Ever since Svetlana made her first comment about, you know, what happened to the world and how do we look at the world, I've been trying to formulate a response to that in the context of this conversation. And I'm not a professional in the world of photography, but I get a sense that maybe you have an idea of the world that is no longer entirely what the lived reality or experience of the world looks like. I get to have a sense that your idea of a representation of the world is grounded on some level in a construction of the world that comes out of the 16th century, which is that the relationship to the world is one that is based on an abstraction of representation, a kind of map making, where, you know, we know since the 16th century that the world is round, but we experience it as flat, and that what we take for a viewing of the world is in fact a sort of radical abstraction akin to a map. Whereas maybe what we're experiencing with this extreme proliferation of images is an attempt to experience the world as a round thing rather than as a flat thing, which interestingly kind of triggered a reversal of what's public and private, in that it used to be that the public images of the world were abstractions, and those that were kind of not abstractions but little fragments remained in the slideshows and the rec room and in the photo albums you showed to your grandparents. And it appears as if maybe those abstractions and representations of the world have now moved into the arena of the quote-unquote private, which is the museum. Maybe the museum has become the private photo album to those who'd like to experience the world as an abstraction or representation. Whereas the internet has become the public arena where we experience the world as round.
No, except for that last comment, which, you know, is kind of the, I always want to say something really stupid. Like, we're looking at a moment of, shall we say, institutional panic. It's MoMA, museums, and of course photography, where we're trying to deal with the fact that what's valued is no longer the aesthetic dimension of something per se, but its navigational capacity in an informational world. And of course, photography has the problem of being something that, by and large, except for its marginal practices, has promised us that it delivers information. So we have the least problem with, I suppose we could say, intersectionality or the histories of those who didn't used to be part of the educated audience but now are, and so it's okay to show documentary images that refer to the long ago or the far away, but we have a problem trying to stop the flow of information on the internet that relates to the politicized images of the now, which leads to a big problem. I won't say that I hung a gigantic flag in the atrium when I was about to hold a show just after Obama was reelected. And the gallery filled with Europeans who thought that MoMA was celebrating the reelection of the president. And it's only when the atrium filled with crap for sale that it became clear that this was a comment on the meaning of physical and informational objects in American culture. So we're talking about the porosity of that momentary hesitation.
Thank you, Martha. Yes.
This is very important, or I wouldn't speak again. But it seems to me in all the discussion of circulation and reception, we haven't spoken about one of the key factors of mass pictorial media, which is simultaneity. I think it's really important that life came the same day each week, and everybody knew that that's when everybody else and lots of, who subscribed to Life and lots of others were going to be seeing this photograph of Gordon Parks in it. And as Michael Warner has discussed, this was part of a known discourse in which everybody participated. It went back to the, because it was a commercial transaction. I mean, you paid for that, and the people creating and disseminating Life wanted you to keep on paying. But, and that, of course, that doesn't happen anymore. I mean, there's a certain, you know, sureness about this, and a kind of, it was, everybody had agreed from, you know, the headquarters of Life to out in wherever you got your magazine. And there is a simultaneity. I mean, simultaneity is a very important force in your viewing, your reception of images, you knowing it's going on everywhere. It's internet images are simultaneous, but nobody's really, as Martha was saying, nobody's really in control, and there's no sort of agreement. I mean, and you don't really have any way of knowing. And that's sort of disturbing. I mean, it sort of makes them less real, I mean, which we kind of maybe know, but don't quite know how to express. I just suggest this sort of covenant about the realness of what Life gave you made it even more real than the things that were in the picture, made it, or helped, was as important to make it real as what was in the photographs. And now maybe there's nothing in place of that.
One of the things in the discussion that I've noticed is there's a lot of talk about what photography is. And when people talk about what photography is, it's quite different than what everyone in the circle is doing. Because the vernacular photography, the internet, it's not photography in terms of making art, and I think that's a kind of important distinction. I mean, we have one of the things about the internet that is the banality of images, the way they all look the same. I mean, we have Penelope Umbrico here, whose work uses search engines of sunsets and things, and they are remarkably similar. And I think one of the things that is going on with photography as art is how is that subjectivity developed? And when I'm speaking about what you're looking at with the camera, it is whether you're looking at the structures or the thing itself. That's not a judgment issue. I mean, I think that's, one can quite look at the structures, and that's kind of an important thing. But I mean, with Erin's work, I can look at her photographs, and I look at a way of thinking about her sculpture, and her sculpture impacts the way I look at her photographs. With Lucas's work, there's a type of breaking of the photograph into the context within it, in where it's made, as well as the specific moments that Erin described very articulately with the type of fruit, with the type of physicality that the camera catches. But I think there is a difference when you are where you point the camera and what that means, and I think that's something that it's an issue to negotiate in different ways.
I mean, it's not going to really answer. I'm still chewing on the things the lady said over there about the innocent, about the camera, because the images are never innocent. Somebody gives them to you. Somebody made them. Somebody sends them to you. But you know, like a thing I just thought about a while, which is a problem when we talk about images. We constantly mingle photographic images. We mingle the thing which is on the photograph with the photograph itself. Mm-hmm. So we think this is about to, in a way it is, but the photograph itself is actually not. The photograph is not a political thing. The photograph became a political thing because it got involved in an argumentation about, you know, can he go out? Can he photograph white people on the street? Is he not allowed? Of course that's important, but a photograph per se is constantly has the trouble that it's kind of being mistaken with what's on the photograph, which is really a different thing. It's like Mona Lisa is a painting of an old lady. It is not an old lady. I mean, a young lady at the time today, she would be pretty old. But that's the one thing. And the other thing is, it's very hard, knowing that, it's very hard to kind of do something with photographs as a political meaning, as somebody who makes photographs themselves. Because the reverb, you know, like when you play a guitar too close to a loudspeaker, is enormous. And there's not that many people which actually can really contribute meaningful comments to that. One of them you showed in your slideshow, which is Grunberg Canarin, when they did the Brecht's Kriegsfibel, you know, like the war primer. That is, when you look at it, it is quite amazing. And what it shows you is that actually in propaganda photography, and that's why I'm saying this as an answer to what you said, in what, when we talk about photography being used for propaganda reasons, not much happened. It's still the same patterns, exactly the same patterns as for the Second World War. Life magazine, you know, there's this fantastic overlapping of the Life magazine where the Cambodian girl is kind of being taken out of the hole. And then you have the photographer to put on top of that is the three soldiers, the three military police people which got Saddam Hussein out of his hole. You know, the rhetorics of the picture is exactly the same. Of course, we have many more layers and it's much more complex to see this, but we know much more about pictures now as well as than people did like 70 years ago. However, it is extremely hard to keep the areas of what photography shows and what photography is apart from each other and then make a comment which is not just kind of another political comment, another political point. So that's why I think photography, especially in the art world, is at the moment, or in the art arena, or whatever you call it, is so happy with subjectivism, because at least you know what you're talking about. You know what I mean? And that is becoming increasingly a problem, I think, but that's what art is about, you know? It's a problem. It's a constant struggle to find a solution for a problem and feeling ways of there is a problem now or something like that, and try to find a form for it.
I'm just thinking in terms of what you're describing. Partially, there's this kind of long-going way in which, you know, the kind of distance between the caption and the image, like just, you know, from the 60s forward, describes, you know, what is photographic in the world. But I'm also wondering from a more material point of view, if the way in which this might be really woo-woo or just because I'm really thirsty, but I'm just wondering if there's a way in which these invocations of water could describe another kind of materiality. Because, I mean, there's just been so many of the ocean of images, the blizzard, the tidal waves, liquidity, and I'm wondering if the kind of portals that you're describing, which are in some ways about a certain kind of method or mode that is, you know, aquatic. I wonder if it has to do with, like, the maybe not to be, like, too technical or materialist, and the makers in this room can tell me, but, like, the relationship of like, the process of production and the role of, you know, kind of laying something onto a thing and the way that water functions in that as another way of kind of locating an agent outside of a subject so that it can be this thing that's maybe not the world but the earth. And yeah, these are just kind of thoughts around.
I think this brings us to Beyonce in some ways.
Big thank you, David. This was my alley to your Beyonce.
All right.
Exactly.
No, but I think in terms of a kind of universally accessible symbol, right? I think in many ways Beyonce is the last pop star. Yeah. And because I think after her, it's impossible. It's impossible to kind of have that authority. And I think that that's what's at risk, is the authority of images, right? So I think the other, following the water analogy, there's this idea of dilution, right? The dilution of the value of images when they hit you. And through consuming so many and discarding them, the authority and the value of them is diminished. You want me to stay with Beyonce?
give us baptism.
Maybe we should go have a drink.
Exactly. On that note, I'd like to thank Thomas and Charlotte and David and Erin and Darsie. Thank you all for joining us. There are drinks outside.